see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself,
welcome to the Its and Queens podcast. I'm your host, Jeff Simmons, and happy St. Patrick's Day. This has always been a moment to celebrate St. Patrick of Ireland with friends, family, and festivities, often in public gatherings in the community and parades across the five boroughs, and of course here in Queens. St. Patrick's Day usually is held on this date, which is marked by the death of St. Patrick, Ireland's most celebrated patron saint. The festivities commemorate St. Patrick and the subsequent arrival of Christianity in Ireland. Now, New Yorkers always go all out for St. Patrick's Day. But this year, once again, will be different because of the pandemic. The sudden cancellation of the parades last year illustrated how disruptive the pandemic would be to our lives. And even though many cities are loosening COVID restrictions, most have not cleared the way for large gatherings like parades, because they still consider them super spreader events. Even the main parade across the East River, the oldest uninterrupted St. Patrick's Day parade in the world, is going to be virtual again this year, showcasing videos of past parade marching groups. And here in our borough, the Queens County St. Patrick's Day Parade Committee in Rockaway Beach announced that the 46th annual parade will be an online compilation of previous parade highlights, but they hope it will go in person next year. It's usually also on this day we head to some of our local restaurants or pubs for cabbage and corned beef, and of course some Guinness. I usually find myself headed to one of the great ones in Woodside, like Donovan's or Saints and Sinners. There's also Copper Kettle, but there's so many options for you to choose from, like Cassidy's Ale House in Jackson Heights or Connolly's Corner in Maspeth. But given the pandemic, check on each place first, just to see if they're open only indoors or outdoors, or curbside pickup, which is another good option. And if you decide to visit any establishments, please make sure to adhere to health and safety guidance as much as possible. Did you know that Queens is home to the New York Irish Center, right on Jackson Avenue in Long Island City? For more than 16 years, the center has been a place to find community, connection, and especially during the pandemic, compassion. The center has been an anchor between young and old, a place for programs and classes for all ages. Clearly, like many other places, its services and programs have had to adapt over this past year. So I caught up with Paul Finnegan, who served as the center's executive director for 11 years until October of last year. We talked about the center's role and future and about his new podcast, Centerpiece NY. So welcome to the It's in Queens podcast. Just a few months ago, after 11 years, you stepped away from your role leading the New York Irish Center. You'd already started thinking about a transition pre-pandemic, and when you were departing, you told the Irish Echo that you had achieved what you had set out to do. What do you hope your legacy leading the institution is?
Sure, Jeff. I like to think that I will be recognized for putting the New York Irish Center on the map and making it sustainable, and even making it great. And also, I'd like to be recognized for having put a great succession plan in place when I did decide to leave. And there's a guy there now called George Heslin in charge, who's just the right guy for the right time for that organization, and he's doing a great job. But I'd also like to be remembered for making the New York Irish Center relevant in this day and age by bearing down on the vision of its founders, by making it a welcoming, inclusive place, that it is a uniter and not a divider in these times. So I actually came up with a tagline for the New York Irish Center, which is maybe above all what I would like to be remembered for, and it is community, culture, and care. So maybe that's my legacy, my greatest legacy, and whether it turns out to be that in the fullness of time, we don't know, but that's what I would hope for.
If our listeners don't know anything about the New York Irish Center, can you just tell me a little bit about the work that it does, when it was founded, and its mission?
Sure. It is in Long Island City, in the Hunters Point area. It's at the very end of Jackson Avenue. The organization owns its own building. It's a fabulous facility for a not-for-profit organization, a community center. It has about 10,000 square feet. And because the organization, as I said, owns its own building, it has survived the vagaries of a very aggressive property market in that area over the last 10 to 15 years. And it has also been in a good place, or was in a good place, during COVID, during the lockdown, in that there was no problem with having to satisfy a landlord's needs during those times. So it put itself in a strong position to be sustainable and to be permanent in that area. Now, again, what does it actually do? Why does it exist? Again, I go back to those three words: community, culture, and care. Let me start with culture. It's primarily built around Irish culture, which is a very, very strong culture, but it's also a very attractive culture, not just to the Irish and Irish Americans, but to all peoples. It's a very attractive culture. So there are a lot of programs built around imparting that culture to all ages, from kids all the way through to seniors. So the cultural offerings in events and classes and such things are the glue that bring the community together. And upon that glue, then, there's a social service component, the care component. And that is where care services are provided. So the New York Irish Center does a lot of work with seniors. It's a great place for seniors, a great place for people at a stage in their life where community is very important. And along the way, the New York Irish Center partnered with an organization as part of its care offerings, an organization that is very strong on preventing suicide and self-harm, and that's Solace House. So they actually have their USA headquarters in the New York Irish Center building in Long Island City, Queens. So instead of trying to invent a program or build a program from scratch, we developed a very strategic partnership with Solace House during my tenure. So that's sort of a wrap of what the New York Irish Center offers. But above all else, we believe, the New York Irish Center believes, that the Irish benefit from being in America, but we also feel that the US is a stronger, better place because of the Irish. So we like to, you know, open our doors to community. And it's a hub for many local organizations that meet there as well, many civic organizations. There's a dearth of meeting places in and around Long Island City, and the New York Irish Center has always had its doors open for other organizations to meet as well.
You mentioned that community is important, and since the pandemic began, so many places have had to change how they operate. People have not been able to meet as often in person or in large gatherings. How has the New York Irish Center adapted during this time? How has the pandemic affected the center?
Well, it was a particularly tough challenge for the New York Irish Center because the whole premise was, you know, it brings people together in a physical environment, close contact, a way to build bonds between people. The idea was if we built it, they would come, and we built it and they came. And then all of a sudden, in an afternoon, we had to, and to use a very overused word, we had to pivot. So basically we went to the virtual world, and the organization has continued that strongly since. A lot of its cultural offerings are now offered online, and are very, very good and done very, very well under George. There's fantastic events being put up online now. Also classes, and classes continue to a certain degree online as well. It's been tough on seniors because they wouldn't be quite as ready to adapt to new technologies as others. So that has been a challenge. But one thing the New York Irish Center did last year was, in lieu of having the seniors come once a week for a communal lunch, we regularly went out with lunches into the community. And it was interesting because for many, many, many years, restaurants and places of hospitality had donated food to the New York Irish Center to have its communal lunch in the building. But now, as a payback, as a pay it forward, or whatever term, you know, as a way to acknowledge all the generosity of these restaurants over many, many years, we paid for the lunches out of our fund, and we were able to distribute those lunches to the seniors. So we also had a rank of volunteer drivers as well to get those lunches out. So that is a
That is an ongoing program at the New York Irish Center to some degree, but ultimately this will end and people will come back. There will be new rules, a new world. There'll be a certain amount of good things that came out of learning how to live in a virtual environment that we would like to keep and that everyone should like to keep. But ultimately, we'll go back to being a physical space where people come together, and with vaccinations and so on, that time is now on the horizon.
So what will you miss the most about working with the center?
Well, I'm emotionally pretty good at putting things behind me, you know? So in one respect, I won't miss anything about the New York Irish Center working there. It's mostly about the people. The people that I, and that's the benefit of being in a like a community center, because the people that I knew through the New York Irish Center, I will continue to know forever. I knew them before the New York Irish Center, and I will know them after the New York Irish Center. And I can always go there for an event when the doors open again. And I pop in to visit every now and then too, you know. So I for various reasons, I offer some corporate memory to the place, so that I am asked a few questions now and then. So I'm still on great terms with everyone at the New York Irish Center. But what I really miss, and which I would have missed anyway, is those members that have passed. And when I first started working at the New York Irish Center, a lot of the help I got was from people that were quite elderly. And as time went on, they went on to their reward. So no matter what, they were going to be gone anyway, and I missed them terribly. So it's not that I don't work there anymore. What do I miss? I miss some of the people that helped me build it through love, blood, sweat, and tears, etc. I miss them very, very much. I'll mention one fellow who lived in Elmhurst, Joe Flannery. I don't mean to single anyone out, but Joe is a legend, and Joe would do anything for me. And at any time when I had very little resources, for example, as they say, when you get a call at 3 o'clock in the morning, I knew that if I had an emergency at 3 o'clock in the morning, I could call Joe and Joe would be ready to help. So may he rest in peace. He passed away in 2019 towards the end of the year. And I'm sure he's in heaven now.
Let's talk about you, your background. Where were you born and what brought you to Queens?
Well, I'm going to tell you something which I tell people, and it never quite fits the profile. I was born in Phoenix, Arizona. My father was an engineer. My parents were from Ireland, but they had come to the United States in the 1950s and moved around to some degree because he was a civil engineer. He was the first in his family to be educated to the college level, to professional level. So my siblings are all born here. I was the last of them. He was primarily based in Phoenix in the last few years. He was in the United States. And I was the last born in the family. I'm the youngest of my siblings. And they had made the decision to move back to Ireland before I was born. But as soon as I was born then, well, they waited for me to be born, basically. And as soon as I was born, they put me on an airplane with them. They took me on an airplane and we went back to Galway. So I was in Galway. I was born in November. And I was in my grandmother's house in Galway City on Christmas Day that year. And I had no knowledge of the United States ever since. It was just a piece of trivia about me that I was born in Phoenix, Arizona. Obviously, later on, I availed of my American citizenship and came back to live. My mother had a strong base of relatives in Brooklyn. So I started off, you know, you go and you sleep on your aunt's couch kind of thing. So I went to Brooklyn and that's how I connected with New York primarily. And I think I fell in love with New York the day I got here and I haven't left since. And I found my way into Queens because there was and there still is a humming community in Woodside where, you know, I hung out with a lot of people from my hometown in Galway were here at the time anyway. So I hung out with them and eventually started renting apartments in and around Woodside and Sunnyside. And then it's quite a while, but one day I decided I needed something a little bit different. I opened the Irish Echo in the first ad for an apartment. That's how you did things back then. I opened the Irish Echo and the first ad in the Irish Echo was for an apartment in Glendale. And I'd never heard of the place. And I remember I had a car and I drove out to Glendale and I had a physical paper map to find Glendale. I found it anyway, and it was a lovely studio apartment with a lady called Helen Brennan down in the basement of her house. And that's how I got into Glendale. And I've been here ever since, met my wife. We bought a house in Glendale and we've lived here ever since. So that's my Glendale story. And I'm, my deep roots at this point in Queens.
So this new chapter in your life, let's talk about that. What are you up to now?
Well, when I decided it was time to leave the New York Irish Center, I felt it was finally time to develop my creative side. The podcast, which I guess we'll talk about, the podcast is one component of that. But primarily, I've always felt the need to be a writer. I've always, you know, been a wordsmith of sorts. I've, you know, through my life at the New York Irish Center and in other places, I've made many, many speeches. And I never could afford a speechwriter, so I wrote all my own speeches. So I enjoy writing. And I feel it's a craft that obviously, you know, needs to be improved. Everyone needs to improve at everything. That's just life. But I really enjoy doing it. And that's the main thing. So as time goes on, the podcast will be one component of my creativity. And in fact, if you listen to my podcast, you're often listening to my writing. So in time, I see myself doing more blogging and maybe go on to do a book and, you know, things like that. Now this'll be a process of 5 to 10 years, so that maybe in 5 or 10 years, I'll have some viable audience that or makes me viable in that domain. So it's a long-term strategy, but I felt it was finally time to commit to it. And enjoy it. And it's, you know, I've always believed, which is one of the reasons I've made many different career choices in my life, is do I enjoy the work primarily? You know, I've done everything from teach New York City public schools to running another not-for-profit to working with computers. I actually enjoy information systems and coding and databases. I also enjoy that stuff too. So I like to follow the path of what I like to do. So this is where I am right now. Now, on top of that, I always love working with not-for-profits. So I'm exploring opportunities to consult in the not-for-profit domain. And then that's another outlet for my creativity. But, you know, I'm also open to leading another organization, and I'm open to opportunities in that area as well. So that's where I'm at, basically. I've just decided to take a path which is doesn't quite fit into a defined label, but it has to involve a lot of me being able to be creative from here on in.
The podcast, Centerpiece NY. You featured some prominent folks. What do you hope to show during these conversations? What do you want to highlight?
I want to have people hear real voices. Many of my interviewees, they've never been asked to tell their life story and have it recorded before, not to that degree. So they're somewhat unpolished as interviewees. I've obviously often talked to people that are familiar with doing media spots, and myself included, have some experience in putting our feet in the shoes of the interviewer. But the people I tend to talk to are wouldn't be in that vein. So I have to do a lot of editing. I have to do a lot of editing to make from A to Z to make it a coherent story, not sequential as much as I have to group themes together properly so that people listening just don't become lost. But again, there's just nothing but gold in the stories of these people's lives. They're quote unquote ordinary people, but I see them as extraordinary. And I believe they are the bedrock upon which community is built. And the Irish have a great reputation in New York. These people are the reason we have such a great reputation. I'm not saying I'll necessarily be restricted to Irish in the fullness of time, but that is basically the theme I'm looking for. So I like to then provide context and history around my centerpieces story, and historical aspects to it as well, so that people who don't have the same frame of reference as me, you know, become a little more connected to the story. And I think, like any podcast, over time you really get to know both the person that's creating the podcast, in this case me, and the context. And it's, you know, the familiarity, you become a friend to the podcast, I suppose, is a way to say it, you know. So that is that's Centerpiece NY in a nutshell.
So you mentioned the Irish community in New York. I'm curious how the Irish community has changed in New York and Queens over time in the last decade or two.
Well, demographically, there has been significant change in the decade or two or three that have passed us now. The the reasons for that are multiple. One of them is that there's a very restricted immigration policy into the United States for everyone. It's really, really hard to become a fully fledged legally working person in the United States. Many of the opportunities to work legally in the United States are short term. They're related to work, job. They're specific to some component that's of benefit to the United States in the short term, but they're not necessarily catered to community building. Now, obviously, there are a lot of people that avail of coming to the United States to build communities, but the Irish may not be one of them at this time. The Irish have always come, that traditionally, historically, the Irish have come to the United States as young single adults, hugely represented by women, by the way, in that regard, young single independent women coming to the United States. The immigration laws are even more restricted for those people in those categories. So what we have is basically a decline in fresh Irish people from the source. What we have now is a growing Irish American diaspora, a growing Irish American category. And with the information age being what it is, and travel pre-COVID and hopefully post-COVID being a lot easier, there's a much stronger connection between Irish America and Ireland. So that is the future of the Ireland, of the Irish in the United States, and probably most especially in New York. I will say, though, that New York City may not have, you know, the level of native Irish people living in it in decades to come as it had in the past. But I think that the Irish is the imprint of the Irish spirit on New York is profound and has significantly shaped the culture here. And I think that will last. I think it will last a very long time. Irish and New York are one and the same in many respects to me. I take, for example, today's parade, which is virtual this year, but in normal times it heads up Fifth Avenue, and it's on a weekday. It's the only parade that's allowed to go ahead on a weekday. Oh, and the only,
that's a good point,
other than weekends and holidays, but it's the only parade of its type that goes ahead on a weekday. And today's the day. It's virtual, of course. The day is all virtual, but next year we'll be going on Fifth Avenue. But I just want my one point that I want to finish with. It's a celebration not only of Ireland and St. Patrick and the Irish, but it's a celebration of and for New York.
So given that it's St. Patrick's Day, how do you recommend people celebrate today?
Well, I will tell you of one event, which is a remarkable event in and of itself. And it's a plug for another group, basically. But they're known as the Sober St. Patrick's Day group. And they have an event at 4 p.m. today, which is all virtual, online, and free. And it starts at 4 p.m. And if you go to, I'm not sure at this point whether it's sold out or not. And I don't understand what virtual sellouts mean, but they do have them. It's soberstpatricksday.org. So that's soberstpatricksday.org. Now, I will say why it's called Sober St. Patrick's Day, because too often the stereotype of drunkenness of the Irish is attached. It's a stereotype in and of itself. We actually don't drink as much as other cultures, would you believe? There are other cultures that far out drink us, but that's another story. It's a way to rebrand St. Patrick's Day and take it away from this mindless Yahoo drinking that goes on St. Patrick's Day, and to give an opportunity for families to have a day, not in an environment that's, you know, to some degree not for them, to a large degree not for them. So there's music and dancing and non-alcoholics around. It's actually a great place for people in recovery that are Irish and love St. Patrick's Day, and here's a chance for them to enjoy something which is separated from alcohol on St. Patrick's Day. Now, in normal times, it's a physical event. At one time, the New York Irish Center did host Sober St. Patrick's Day on St. Patrick's Day, and hopefully, again, next year, it'll be back in a physical venue, and it definitely will sell out then.
So as I wrap up, Paul, where should people go if they'd like to check out Centerpiece NY and also learn more about you?
Well, it's taking Centerpiece on its own, Centerpiece NY on its own. I have a website, centerpieceny.com. Maybe you have some show notes. You can drop these things in. I don't know, but centerpieceny.com. And also you can at centerpieceny, you can find me on, find it on Twitter and Facebook. And then my own personal Twitter account is a good way, I suppose, to hear my voice now and then and my nonsense. And my Twitter handle is at Paul_NY. So it's at Paul_NY. And you can always look up my profile on LinkedIn and all the cool things that I say I did. It's based on a true story.
Paul Finnegan, thank you so much for appearing here on the It's in Queens podcast, and happy St. Patrick's Day.
Happy St. Patrick's Day to you too, Jeff. Thank you for the opportunity to come on your show today.
That was my conversation with Paul Finnegan, and I encourage you to check out his podcast, Centerpiece NY, and it features New York Irish stories, the lives of longstanding members of New York's Irish community, and in their own words. It's said that everyone's Irish on St. Patrick's Day. Even if that's true, not everyone celebrates March 17th as if they were from Ireland. I just read a story this past week, and it pointed out that St. Patrick's Day has always been a much bigger affair here in America than in Ireland. And so, if you want to celebrate March 17th like the Irish do, there are a few things to just keep in mind. First, consider abstaining from alcohol. St. Patrick's Day is a holy day of obligation for Irish Roman Catholics. Because of that, and that it happens during the Christian season of Lent, it's a period of somber reflection, so the sale of alcohol had been banned on that day. Now, while the St. Patrick's Day prohibition was lifted by the government in Ireland about 60 years ago, still, many Irish people still observe that tradition to this day. And another fact, a typical feast wouldn't involve corned beef. A typical feast would feature a leg of lamb with rosemary, shepherd's pie, and meat or fish pies. And of course, do not forget the soda bread. If you're itching to celebrate with others on St. Patrick's Day or discover what else is happening in Queens over this next week, you don't have to go far. The person who always comes up with the best things to do is Rob Mackay of the Queens Economic Development Corporation and Queens Tourism Council. Each week, his reports highlight the online and in-person activities that are happening in our borough. Here's his report.
Well, hello, Jeff. I'm wondering if you've ever heard of Marvin Hamlisch. Actually, I'm not wondering. I'm positive you have. But in case you haven't, he was a composer who won 3 Oscars, 4 Grammys, 4 Emmys, 1 Tony, 1 Pulitzer Prize, and 3 Golden Globes over his 50-plus year career. But here's my follow-up question. Did you know that he graduated from Queens College? That's right, 1967, with a Bachelor of Arts degree. Anyway, Marvin Hamlisch had an incredible career, and he, even though he died in 2012, he still lives on. There's a foundation in his name. The guy worked with everyone. There are all kinds of different things, and there's actually been something called the Marvin Hamlisch International Music Awards, which will broadcast on May 22nd at 7 o'clock. That's right, Monday, May 22nd at 7 o'clock, and Queens College is co-hosting. It's a ceremony and mini concert set up to basically to promote emerging composers all around the world, and of course to keep Hamlisch's legacy intact. But this year there are going to be a bunch of awards and some incredibly famous presenters, including Barbara Streisand, Quincy Jones, Idina Menzel, Melissa Manchester, if you know her, Sir Howard Stringer, Johnny Mathis, and Lucy Arnaz. They will be giving awards to different composers from around the world in certain different categories. And of course, there will be all kinds of entertainment going on as well. The Golden Globes or whatever didn't do that well. But this is going to be a smash hit. Just in case you haven't heard of Hamlisch, he wrote scores, songs, dance arrangements, musical themes, everything for Broadway productions such as Funny Girl and A Chorus Line. He actually was wrote scores for more than 40 movies, including a couple of Woody Allen's pieces and The Sting, which was the more famous one on Scott Joplin. He wrote stuff for TV shows in England and the U.S., and he also traveled the world as a conductor or writer for many of the major orchestras, including Philadelphia Orchestra, the National Symphony Orchestra, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. You probably actually have heard him on albums without knowing it, because he also collaborated with people like Aretha Franklin and the Carpenters. Anyway, if you get a chance, Kupferberg Center of the Arts at Queens College will be broadcasting the Marvin Hamlisch International Music Awards this Monday, March 22nd at 7 p.m., It's free. It's open to the public. You can watch it on Marvin Hamlisch TV or find out about it through Queens College's Kupferberg Center of the Arts. That's going to be it for me, Jeff. But remember, there's a lot more going on in Queens this week. Find out all of it on itsinqueens.com or look for us on social media with any kind of a hashtag or backslash followed by It's in Queens. All right, thanks. See you soon.
That was Rob McKay of the Queens Economic Development Corporation and Queens Tourism Council, the sponsor of this podcast. Earlier this week, remember, if you can, our clocks jumped ahead an hour. And you know what that means. Yes, spring is afoot. This Saturday, March 20th, spring begins, the vernal equinox, when the sun crosses the celestial equator. Spring is when we transform from darkness to light, from cold to warmth. Gray days become ones filled with bright colors that are spread across our parks and our lawns and our courtyards. Spring is when we clean house and plant gardens. And yes, we see and then hear all those baby birds outside. Comedian Robin Williams once remarked that spring is nature's way of saying, let's party. And I bet that many of us right now are feeling that way, not just about St. Patrick's Day, but as vaccinations pick up and new cases of the virus hopefully continue to drop down. So I too cannot wait to get out again, to see people in person for larger celebrations. They will happen eventually when we can toast the end of this pandemic and brighter days ahead, not just during the spring. I'm your host, Jeff Simmons. See you next week on the It's in Queens podcast.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world.